Let's discuss about the design procedure for the shoe brake, and we have completed our introductory part in the previous class, and this class is purely focusing on the design procedure of shoe brake. So actually the design procedure of shoe brake is really interesting and very easy to do. So let's see how it is being carried out. So the initial step, in the initial step we are supposed to calculate the amount of torque required or transmitted, because this much amount of torque need to be absorbed when we design the brake. So to do that, we have an equation on the third chapter. This is the most important thing. This equation is available in the third chapter. Right now in our data handbook, we are dealing with our 13th chapter. This is a data handbook by Mahavira or Balavir Reddy. In that data handbook, 13th chapter deals about the design of clutch and brake couplings, and this particular equation can be found from the equation 3.3a in the chapter number 3. So you have to use this equation. Only thing is that you have substitute n in RPS. Okay, so you just refer the data handbook and see what exactly is given over there, and substitute P in kilowatts. So you substitute the P in kilowatts, and what you are going to get is in Newton M. That is the meaning. Okay, so using this equation, this is the alternative form of the equation 2 pi NT by 60. They are one of the same. No, don't worry about these two equations. They are one of the same. So if you use a kilowatt, you are going to get the value of torque is in Newton M. Now, in the second step, we are going to calculate the tangential force using the equation 13.16 m, and that is given in the page number 266. This we have already explained. We can say that Ft is Ft into R is equal to torque. So T by R is nothing but Ft. That's what is given here. D is the diameter of the brake drum. And when you do this, you can see that you have to calculate. So while solving this, from this equation definitely you can find out the value of Ft, no issue. And in the third step, you are supposed to find out the effective friction value. Effective friction value. See, when we take the case of a brake drum and a brake shoe, say this is the brake shoe, and let's draw a brake drum. Brake drum, and this is the brake shoe. This is the brake drum, brake shoe. So this is the center. So if you connect these two towards the center, you are going to get an angle of 2 theta here. And if 2 theta is greater than 60 degree, some textbook says that it is 2 theta greater than 45 degree. Either of these two. Anyway, don't worry. If these values are greater than 60 or 45, you are supposed to find out the effective friction value. Effective friction value. Effective friction value can be found using this equation. So also given here, right below the equation 13.16 m, you have this equation mu into 4 sin theta divided by 2 theta plus sin 2 theta. Most of the students will commit a mistake while substituting in this equation. For example, if 2 theta is equal to some say 70 degree, then how will you calculate? Definitely after the calculation you are going to get the value of mu dash greater than mu. Mu dash will be greater than mu. If you are not getting that, the meaning is that you have committed some mistake here. So just look, observe here how the substitution is being done. For example, mu is equal to 0.3, then substitution is something like this: 0.3 into 4 sin theta. 2 theta is 70, so theta is going to be 35. Divide by here 2 theta, it has to be in radians. So 70 into pi by 190 plus sin 70. So this is how the substitution should look like. So make sure that you are doing the proper substitution. Okay, now comes the step number 4, which is the most important part. We are supposed to find out the actuating force here. Now, you look here, we have got three figures, figure A, figure B and figure C here, and we have to sort out the figure from these three, which is going to resemble that of our question, and we have to select the equation from these two. That is how we are going to do it. Now let's see. I will draw a brake shoe and a drum. This is a drum, and say this is the brake shoe. Say it is something like this. It is being getting connected like this. So this is the brake drum. This is a, say this is a question given to you. This is a question given to you. This is center. If you compare this figure with the one which is given in your data handbook, one thing we can say that they are not one or the same, because here you have the brake shoe and the lever on the upper part or the top side. Here everything is on the bottom side. But you have to understand one thing is that irrespective of the figure given in the question, definitely you can find a match. You can relate the one which is given in your figure or in a question to the one in your data handbook. So in order to do that, you have to be very careful while analyzing it. The first thing is that you should look at the location of the hinge, this pivot point. This pivot point has three orientations. You look here in this figure. Here, this pivot is in line with the brake shoe. Here, the pivot is away from the brake shoe. This is the brake shoe. The pivot is away from the brake shoe. You can see a distance C. Or here is the location of FT. It has to be either in this direction or in this direction. This is the way in which FT acts. And here if you look, you can see that the pivot is lying in between sender and the action of FT. So these are the three possible locations of C. C can be in line with FT. C can be away from FT, and C can be in between FT and the center. So if you look at this figure, we can see that this fulcrum is here. This is the location of FT. So this pivot is lying in between the center and the fulcrum. So the figure that is going to match the one in the question is figure C. Here C is also in between the center and the FT. So for this question, C is the match. So this is how you have to sort out the figure. Now the question is, if this is the figure C that is going to help us in solving the question, among these two equations, which one we have to select? Whether we have to go for the clockwise rotation or we have to go for the counterclockwise rotation. The answer is very simple. You may think that it's very simple. So in the question, if they have given it as clockwise, you have to select clockwise. If it is anti-clockwise, here also anti-clockwise. No, that is not the criteria for selection. So just look here. I will explain that very clearly. You just need to be very patient. What we need to do is that here, the direction of rotation given is clockwise. So the FT is going to act in this direction. When you take the case of brake shoe, this is the direction of FT. Now, in this figure C, which direction of rotation is going to give FT acting away from the fulcrum? You look here, in the question, FT is acting away from the fulcrum. So, in the figure C, you have to select the direction that is going to create an FT away from the fulcrum. So if that is the case, here you have to take the anti-clockwise rotation. So if it is anti-clockwise rotation, then FT is going to act like this. Here FT is acting away from the fulcrum. So the equation that is going to match the clockwise rotation in this question is the counterclockwise one in this data handbook. Sometimes the figures will match, then you don't have any kind of confusion. There will not be any kind of confusion. And if the figures don't match, definitely you have to sort one figure from this. And based upon the direction of FT, you have to choose the equation. Suppose if the direction of rotation was anti-clockwise, definitely here FT would have acted towards the fulcrum point. Then here, the clockwise rotation will give a direction of FT towards the fulcrum point. Then we have to select the clockwise rotation. So that is how you have to select the figure. So select the figure based upon the position of pivot points, and equations are based upon the direction of FT. Right? So right now we have calculated, we have the value of FT with us, we have the value of B, A, etc., mu, etc. And from this equation we will get the value of F. And when it comes to the case of mu, you have to use the effective friction. Suppose if the angle is 2 theta is greater than 45 degree, use mu dash for all the calculation, don't use mu. Everywhere you have to use mu dash. Here also we can calculate the self-locking condition. So if you look here, suppose if this was the question, and if you take this bracket, we can say that 1 by mu minus C by B. If you cross multiply, you can say that this should be less than or equal to 0. So 1 by mu should be less than or equal to C by B. So if B less than or equal to mu C. So this is the one which we have already explained. So this is the condition for self-locking. Here also this one. So in short, we can say that B should be less than or equal to mu C. Right? So this is how self-locking condition is being defined. Now, after calculating the actuating force, our next step is to design the shoe. To do the design of shoe, we will initially calculate the Fn using the equation 13.16F. Right? So equations are very simple. We know that Ft is equal to mu into Fn, and Fn equal to Ft by mu, right? And what is Ft? Ft is nothing but T by R or 2T by D. That is what is here given here. So find the value of Fn. Now we have to calculate the ABS, breaking area, using the equation Fn by P. And this P can be, P is available there in your data handbook. There is a table in the last section of the data handbook where you can get the value of allowable pressure. So select the allowable pressure from there. Fn you have calculated, find the value of ABS. This is the projected area normal to the direction of Fn. That is the area that is required for the break. Now look here. Next one is the calculation of width of the break lining. For that we are using the equation 13.16i. These are empirical relations. B L equal to BD minus 5 to 10. 5 to 10 mm means you can select 5, 6, 7, 8, anything, any value. Anyway, the value of BD, you reduce 5 to 10 mm, you get the value of BL. It's the width of the break lining. And the value of BD is available here from the 13.6a. Look up based upon the diameter of the brake drum, you can select the value of width and radial clearance. Right? So you will get the value of BL, and finally you can get the projected length of the brake lining using the equation 13.16. ABS we have already calculated, BL right now we have calculated, the only thing that is left is L. So by using this equation we can get the length of the brake lining. So width of the brake lining and length of the brake lining, area of the brake, normal and correct area, all these things need to be calculated. Right? So we have, right now we have calculated the design of, completed the design of shoe, and moving forward we are going to calculate the or design the lever. For that we are going to use the equation in the chapter number 1, this is the bending equation. We are going to use the first and last terms, M by I equal to sigma by C. And you can use the table 13.1.3a. There you have got different cross sections, you can get the value of I. Sigma you have to assume, say 150 or 200 or 250. If the lever is made up of metal, you are assuming that is 200, 250, that is the value of sigma. And C is going to be, is also given in the table 13.1. For example, I will say, let's say, I will take the cross section as a rectangle. Say this is B and this is D. And the question, it is given that D is equal to 2B. given. If not given, you have to assume d equal to 2b or 1.5b, anyway, some kind of assumptions like that. And in this table, they have given the value of I as b dq by 12. For rectangular section, it is b dq by 12, right? So you can substitute b, d in terms of b here, and c is going to be d by 2. So it is 2b by 2, that is going to be b. So you can substitute the value of c in terms of b. And what is the value of m? In order to find the value of m, you have to solve the lever. So say that's what I have explained there in the introductory plot. Kindly refer that. Say if this is O and say this is the location of Fn, and say this is the location of Ft, and this is the value of C, and this is the value of F. You just need to take the moment about O, considering Fn, Ft and F. That is the actual practice. And if you are not ready to do all this calculation, there is no problem. You can multiply F into this distance, say A plus B. That is also fine, but that is not accurate. This is on the higher side. It offers another factor of safety. The actual value is the moment about the point O by considering the Fn and Ft. So substitute all these values, the unknown will be b, get the value of b. That's how you design the lever. So if the lever is a circular one, definitely we are going to use the equation pi d raised to 4 by 64. That's all. And finally, after the designing of lever, we have to calculate the heat dissipation using the equation mu p af into v. Everything is available there in the table. Direct substituting, you are going to get the value of heat generated. So this completes the design procedure of a single shoe brick. So the design is very straightforward. There is no complications. You are using only basic equation to find the value of dimensions and all those things. And even if you don't have the data handbook also, you can solve this, because we are using only basic elementary mechanics courses and systems. There is no complex equations. Everything is straightforward. And by applying the basic fundamental mechanics principles, you can solve this. Anyway, you have the data handbook. You can use that one to find the answer. So this is the design procedure. Kindly go through this video once again. And if you have any kind of doubt, please contact me through the chat box. I will reply you. And in the next class, I will explain the design procedure of double shoe brake. What is the difference between single shoe and the double shoe brake?